Professor Sir James Merlies, Mr. Hessler, fellows, honorable guests, and fellow students. Welcome to today's public lecture, Learning to Speak Lingerie, Chinese Entrepreneurs in Egypt. I'm Tiffany Chan, today's Masters of Ceremonies. We are honored to have Mr. Hessler, our distinguished visitor, give a public lecture today. To begin, may I please invite our College Master, Professor Sir James Merlies, to deliver his opening remarks. Professor Merlies, please.
It's a great pleasure to welcome Peter Hessler to come and give a public lecture, and a pleasure to welcome those of you who are here. You're going to enjoy this. We run this series of distinguished visitors who come to the college. Nowadays, once every year, we try to have a visitor who has got something really interesting to tell us, and who talks to the students and the fellows and so on, and we have this public lecture. Let me tell you something about Peter Hessler. He might be described as a journalist, but those of you, probably most of you, who have looked at the New Yorker seriously will know that the New Yorker carries very long pieces which have been very carefully researched and thoughtfully written. So that really the right term is author or writer. But he has also worked for other more straightforward and conventional newspapers. His first degree was Princeton. He then went to Oxford as a Rhodes Scholar, all the while doing English. But it must have been at that point that he went to China on as part of the Peace Corps from the United States. Spent 2 years in, to call it near Chongqing doesn't seem to be quite right, since he says at the time it took 8 hours to get there by slow boat on the Yangtze. That showed him a great deal, as he was teaching the Chinese, some of them, how to teach English. He of course, learned a great deal and found out more than you could imagine about the way people live and think. Now, in a way, what he's going to talk to us about tonight is a bit like that. But he has written a number of books that have grown out of his Chinese experience then and later. But more recently, he spent a long time living in Cairo, in Egypt, as you know. And we get the results of the combination of his awareness of these two different areas. He speaks and writes Chinese. He knows Arabic, which he will tell you is not as good as his Chinese, but I suspect, well, since I have none of either, I feel that this is very impressive. But let me just tell you, before we get on to what this evening's talk is about, what are the basic titles of his existing books. He has, of course, published at least 4. River Town, which would be on that first period. Oracle Bones continues with China. Country Driving, which I believe is also about China, although I think he has extensive driving experience in many parts of the world. And the last one, Strange Stones, which perhaps is more miscellaneous. But he's going to talk to you about another language today, lingerie. And I think I have to leave him to explain what this is. Although afterwards you can go and read a very fascinating long article that was published in the New Yorker about just this. Peter Hessler, thank you for coming. Please give you a call.
Would Professor Merlise please stay and present a souvenir to Mr. Hessler on behalf of Morningside College? Mr. Hessler, please. Thank you, Professor Merlise and Mr. Hessler. Would Professor Merlise and Mr. Hessler please stay? May I now invite fellows and our guests for photo taking? Would fellows and guests come up to the front for a group photo, please? Thank you. The public lecture will start now.
Okay. Thanks so much, and thanks to everybody for coming today, and thanks especially to Morningside for hosting me. This has been amazing weather in Hong Kong. I think I've never seen anything like it. Today I'm going to talk about, I'm going to explain what the lingerie dialect is, which is an unusual concept, but I think before I start, I mean, one of the points of this lecture is to talk about how a research project unfolds. I mean, how do you get the idea to pursue a subject, especially a somewhat unusual subject? And in this case, the genesis of this project was pretty unusual, and so that's what I'm going to start with. Before I begin, I should probably talk about why we went to Egypt in the first place. I lived in China from 1996 to 2007, and that's when I wrote my series of three books about China. My wife, Leslie Chang, is also a writer. And we left in 2007 after each of us had been here for 11 years. We had finished researching our last books, and we decided we were gonna go back to the United States for a while to write the books and hopefully to have children. And we made the decision at that time that we wanted to go to a new place, to a different country that neither of us had had experience in. We felt like we didn't want to only research China because we thought it would be useful to know a different part of the world. And so we thought about places that we wanted to go somewhere that had a rich language because each of us had enjoyed that aspect of China, having a challenging but also a very distinctive language that's a strong part of the culture. And I wanted to go to a place that had a deep sense of history. I had always enjoyed that in China as well. And my second book, Oracle Bones, had a lot of material about archaeology. And so I, when we were thinking about places, we decided the Middle East and decided on Egypt. And this was back in 2007. And one thing that everybody told me at that time when we were talking about doing this was that, well, you know, after China, Egypt is going to seem very quiet. You know, nothing ever happens there. Nothing ever changes in Egypt. This was in 2007. And so we wrote our China books. We had twin daughters in 2010. And by the time we made the move to Egypt in 2011, quiet was not what you would describe it as anymore. We moved there in the year of the Arab Spring. We arrived in Cairo in October of that year after Mubarak had fallen from power, but before many of the real revolutionary changes had started happening. And so we were there during the early years
of the first post-revolution elections when they elected a legislature, and then in 2012 when they elected the first democratically elected president in Egyptian history, who was Mohamed Morsi, a member of the Muslim Brotherhood. And the Muslim Brotherhood was in power for a year, as some of you may remember, from 2012 until 2013, with all kinds of opposition, a very chaotic year that finally culminated in 2013 with a series of protests that led to a coup. And the military took over in July of 2013. Morsi was imprisoned and the Brotherhood was forced out of power. And in response, there were protests by supporters of Morsi all around Egypt. This is a shot. This was a mosque in Cairo called El Rab El Adawiya. And this is where the Islamists gathered in support of the deposed president. And this is a shot from that summer after the coup, immediately after the coup. And I spent a lot of time that summer reporting on this and talking to people there. And there was always a strong feeling that the government was only going to put up with this for so long. And sure enough, on the morning of August 14th, 2013, they cleared this area of these protesters with incredible brutality. And more than 1,000 people were killed, probably the greatest, largest scale massacre in the capital since Tiananmen Square in 1989. Really shocking violence. One difference was that there had been some weapons among the supporters of Morsi, but by and large, most of those people were not armed. So this was a very tense time. And after this event, actually, my wife and my children stayed in America for a couple of months, and I was reporting in Egypt. And in response to this massacre, there were protests in many parts of Egypt. And show you the map. Cairo's up there. In Egypt, they refer to the south, you know, because the Nile flows to the north. The south is called Upper Egypt. That's what it was traditionally in antiquity known as Upper Egypt. And I had done a lot of research in this region before the coup and before the massacre. And there was a lot of violence in this town called Minya, which is a pretty heavily populated place in Upper Egypt. And in particular, you know, there were supporters of Morsi burned Christian churches, Coptic Christian churches, government offices. And there was a little town here called Malawi, which is located about there, where a mob burned down a Christian church and a government building, and they overran the local museum. And I had been doing some research in that area. So I went back a couple of months after this. And in that town, which was a small place, about 18 people had been killed during this violence. And when I visited, the museum was still showing the marks of what had happened. The gates had been broken. This is the museum there in Malawi. This is not it's a very poor, very remote place, but in ancient times it was quite important. There was a capital of Egypt at one point, was across the river from here. And so they had some amazing artifacts in this museum. And this mob showed up at the gates of the museum, and the staff tried to defend the place. And actually the ticket taker was shot and killed. And finally the staff fled and the mob overran the museum. And when I visited, this is what the main exhibition hall looked like. The museum originally had 1,089 artifacts, and 1,043 of those 1,089 had been stolen. And they smashed all of the display cases and took all of these incredibly valuable artifacts. When I was there, the police were in the process of recovering these things, often negotiating with gangs and other groups that had come into possession of these things. And I talked to the museum curator and I talked to people in the area, and everybody had the same thing. When I said, well, who did this? And they said, well, it wasn't people from Malawi, which is what they always said. Anytime you went somewhere in Egypt where there was a lot of violence and you say, well, who came and did this? Who did this? And they say, well, it wasn't us. It was outsiders. And in this town, they said it was foreign agents who did this. It was the Americans.
And I, you know, even when I talked to the governor of the province, who was a former police official, when I asked him about this, he said there were 18 churches were burned in your province. What was the cause of this? And he said it was Obama. Totally serious. And this is the highest official in the province told me that Obama had been responsible for this, that they had paid for agents to come there. And keep in mind that when I visited this place, I was doing research across the river on an archaeology site, and I had driven down there. I had a car, and I would drive on my own on these trips. And so I showed up alone in this place as an American, telling people I'm an American journalist. And this is what they were telling me. And I went across the museum because there was a little market across from the museum, which in Egyptian is called Madad, which means it's just a kind of open-air mall sort of thing that you find all over Egypt. And in this place, a car had been parked in front, and the mob had set fire to the car and burned it, and that wreckage was still there. And I was talking to the locals and asking them, you know, who did this, you know, speaking in Arabic, and the same story. They said, oh, the Americans did it, the foreign agents. It wasn't locals. It was the foreign agents. And chatting with me in a very friendly way. Egyptians are really incredibly friendly, gregarious people, and they like to talk. So we were talking about this, and there was a small group developed around me. You know, I was fairly, I wasn't on edge, but I was being pretty alert because, you know, I was there alone. And while we were talking, some guy comes in and he says, there's a Chinese guy in the market, which is a very strange thing to say because nobody had any idea that I had anything to do with China, of course. And actually, the word for Chinese, Sini, in Arabic, is very similar to Sinai. So at first, I wasn't even 100% sure if he was talking about Chinese. It's so, there's no foreigners in these places. And I said, you mean somebody from China, not from Sinai? He said, yeah, there's a Chinese guy in the market. And he was just telling me this because he thought it was so funny that there's a Chinese guy there. And so I said, really? Can you take me to this guy? He said, sure. You know, so they take me back inside this kind of maze of little stalls and, you know, cheap goods and you know, dishware and clothes and so on. And sure enough, we come to the back of this place, and there's a Chinese guy in the back of this market in Malawi, and he's selling these sort of Chinese, you know, light dresses and lingerie. And you know, his name is Yeda, he tells me. And so I, you know, start talking to him in Chinese and asking him about what he's doing there. And he's, you know, he's there with his wife who was on break. You know, we have a long conversation about this. And the whole time I'm sort of thinking, well, these guys had just told me that foreign agents had been responsible for the violence in their town. And they've just had an American who came in a car, first speaking with them in Arabic. And then they introduced him to the Chinese guy, and he switches over to Mandarin. And there was a police station right down the street. And I was wondering, you know, how long it would be before somebody comes and asks me some questions about what I'm doing there. But nobody ever came. And when I left, the guys in the market were, you know, they you know, gave me a warm send-off. And I came back several times, and they would always greet me, you know, in a very friendly manner. I mean, it told me something about these conspiracy theories that you hear in the Middle East, but I think also in America and in other places. Which is that it's in some ways an expression of helplessness where they wanted their enemies to be distant. In some ways, there was something comforting about that. And the fact that I was there in front of them as a real human being made me not a target, actually. That wasn't what they were looking for. They wanted to keep the problems, that the problems were something that they couldn't control, and it was more of a distant, you know, a method of distancing themselves from the bad things that had happened and from things that they were partly responsible for. So I visited him a couple of times, went to his apartment. The second time I went there, he told me he wanted to cook me a meal. And we went to the market, and he had a lot of trouble getting food, and he ended up buying camel meat by mistake. He thought he was buying beef, and so he had to throw away what he was cooking. And I mean, this was really tough conditions. When I went into their apartment, which was pretty dismal, they had exactly one book, which was this book. You can see the subtitle there is, what does it say? Ni shi zi di zhui hao de yi sheng. So, you know, you are your best doctor, because they weren't going to be getting medical care in Malawi.
And so I asked him, you know, why are you here doing this? And he said, well, you know, my cousin, Ye Junhai, is in Minya, 30 miles down the river, and doing the same thing. So on another trip, I stopped by and stopped in Minya, and sure enough, I went into another mall that had a big Quranic verse on the outside that had some Quranic verse about jealousy, and I go inside, and there's a little shop called the Chinese Lingerie Corner in Arabic. And there's Ye Haidrin, who's running the shop, along with his wife. And as I talked to these people, I realized that there were Chinese people in pretty much every town in Upper Egypt doing this kind of business. And I started coordinating it with my other research in the region. Every time I went to a new city in Upper Egypt, I would just ask people, are there any Chinese people here? And there were so few foreigners in these places. There's really the only foreigners who do business in these types of towns are sometimes some Syrians. But otherwise, you would never have anybody. And so one day, when I went to Asyut, which is a pretty big place, I just pulled over, parked my car, and I called over a cabbie, got in the cab, and I said, are there Chinese people here? And he's like, oh, yeah, there's Chinese people. And then he drove me, through town. And sure enough, we come to a place, a store that has a big sign in Arabic that says Chinese Lingerie. And down the street from that place was another shop that was called China Star. And down the street from that one, also in Asyut, was Noma China. And so I did this, followed this pattern for about a 300-mile stretch of the Nile. Basically, as I went going upstream. So when I was in Beni Swift, there was a market that was run by the Syrians, and somehow there were two Chinese who had embedded themselves with the Syrians, and they were selling lingerie. When I went to Minya, there were six Chinese there. There was another eight of them in Asyut. There were two in Sohag. When I went to this little place called Nega Hamadi, people told me, oh, the Chinese just left, but you could still see the sign. Their brand was still there. That was a sign that says Il Mare di Sini, which means the Chinese market. And while I was doing this, I was also looking at the products, which to me struck me as pretty bizarre. I mean, Upper Egypt is very, Egypt in general is a very conservative country, especially for women's dress. And Upper Egypt is known as the most conservative part of the country. There are Christians there, probably about 10% Christians, but even the Christian women were dressed very conservatively. All of the Muslim women will have their heads covered, and quite a few wear the niqab, you know, the garment that you've seen, sort of like a burqa, where it has just an opening for their eyes. And yet the things that they were selling in these shops were not what I would have assumed would be dress appropriate in Upper Egypt. A number of them were by a brand called Hangzhou, and I asked the dealers where they got this, and they said, I said, what's this Hangzhou brand? They said, oh, that's actually made in Cairo, but he's using the Chinese name for branding. And I found the guy who was in charge of Hangzhou, and sure enough, it was in Cairo. And he's a guy named Dong. And he said he had 40 relatives all over Egypt selling this stuff that he was making in this little factory in Cairo. And after that, I started to meet Dongs everywhere. I met a bunch of them in Alexandria and other towns, and they were all relatives of this guy making this stuff. And, you know, so at this point, I was really curious. And to me, this was a mystery. What's the demand for this product? How did the Chinese figure this out? What's going on here? So I decided this, even though I had stumbled on this accidentally, this is something I wanted to sort of unpack a little bit. Of course, I mean, there is a big movement of Chinese activity outside of China, especially in Africa. And this really kicked off in 1996, which is when Jiang Zemin gave a famous speech where he told Chinese companies to go out, to leave China, to do business outside of China. This is the first time that a Chinese leader had told Chinese enterprises to do this. And so that was a signal that got a lot of state-owned enterprises and other big companies involved. They wanted, partly because resources are dwindling in China, partly because they want new markets, and because the Chinese economy was becoming mature enough to do this. And now there's more than a million Chinese who are doing business in Africa. There's a book by Howard French called China's Second Continent, which is an excellent
introduction to that. One of the things that he mentions is that there's a lot of official state-directed Chinese activity. Between 2001 and 2010, the Export-Import Bank of China gave more loans to African countries than the World Bank did. So this is really activity on a massive scale. But what I was looking at was something different. This was individual. This was not driven by a government policy. These were people that had found their own way to Egypt. Every place in Africa has a Chinese business association with a Huizhang. You know, the Huizhang is the director or the president who runs this association. And when I went to the one in Cairo, this is on the outskirts of Cairo, the president was a guy named Chen Jiannan. And, he had started his business in Egypt, he told me, as a lingerie dealer. And now he had a factory that made shoes and one that made window frames and another one that was assembling solar panels. And I asked him about how he got started in lingerie. And I said, how did you find this product? And he said, somebody who does business just sees these things differently. It's like a hunter. A hunter goes out into the wild and he'll spot a rabbit or a deer or some other animal. He knows what he's looking for. It's the same for a businessman. He sees whatever is in demand. I asked him where he was from and he said, Wenzhou, which was what pretty much every lingerie dealer I had met told me. Every single one of them was from Zhejiang. Most of them were from towns right around Wenzhou. For my third book, For Country Driving, I'd spent a lot of time in Wenzhou, which is most people in China are familiar with the Wenzhou business people. And I made repeated trips there between 2005 and 2008. And one of my favorite things was a stop in the bookstore in the airport when I would arrive in Wenzhou, because they had a whole shelf, a whole section that was books about Wenzhou business. For people who are coming to Wenzhou could read about their tradition there. And these are some of the titles. Kepa, the Wenzhou Ren, the feared Wenzhou people. The collected secrets of success of the Wenzhou people. The Wenzhou Code, deciphering the culture of a kingdom of business. And the one that was my favorite, which is the Jews of the East. The commercial stories of 50 Wenzhou business people. And one thing that I always found fascinating is that people from Wenzhou actually like to read these books too. One time I was in a factory in Lishui, a little bit outside of Wenzhou, and there was a Wenzhou businessman who was setting up this plan. He was reading this book about the Jews of the East. And he asked me if I knew any Jews in America, and I said, yeah, no, I know lots of Jews. I write for The New Yorker. And he said, are they good at doing business? And I said, well, some Jews do business, some Jews do other. They do all kinds of things. And he said, well, it says here that Jews are famous in Europe for doing business. And I said, yeah, well, that traditionally was true. Historically. And he said, well, this book says that the Jews are the Wenzhou people of Europe, which was an idea that I'd never really thought about before. But I think in truth, the big difference is that the Wenzhou people are sort of masters of the niche economy. I mean, they find some little product, some need that they can fill, and then they dominate that. And when I was doing my research there, one of my favorite things was just to drive around towns in Wenzhou. And sometimes I would just pull over and ask people, what do you make here? One time I stopped in a little place called Wuyi, really tiny place. And I asked, what do you guys make here? And this guy pulls a pack of playing cards out of his pockets. He's like, this is what we make, puka pie. And sure enough, when I did research later, they make 1 billion decks of cards a year in that town. There's another place I visited called Yiwu, which makes 1/4 of the plastic drinking straws in the world. Another place called Yongkang makes 95% of the scales made in China. Songsha makes 350 million umbrellas every year. A place called Shangguan makes table tennis paddles. Fenchui makes pens. Datang makes 1/3 of the socks on earth. And 40% of the world's neckties are made in a place called Shengzhou. And one time I was driving outside of Wenzhou and I went through a little place called Chaoto,
And I pulled over there, and they had a statue in the middle of the town. Does anybody tell me what that's a statue of? I think that's the only statue of a button in the world. As far as I know, correct me if I'm wrong, but this is, and it turned out that Chalto has 380 factories that make buttons. And they make 70% of the buttons for clothes that are made in China. So, I mean, probably everybody here who has clothes on that has buttons, the buttons are from Wenzhou. And when you went to the mall, there was a mall right behind this this big button statue. And the only thing you could buy in the mall was buttons. It was just an entire mall of buttons. You know, so this is people that are manufacturing. So they have this incredible ability to make things at scale and turn these little products into a commodity. One thing that's very striking about Wenzhou, of course, is that this had not been planned by the government. It's not like Shenzhen, which was given, you know, preferential treatment and was set up as a kaifachu in a special economic zone. Everything in Wenzhou just happened kind of organically. They never had preferential policies. And the educational system actually traditionally wasn't very strong. Most of these entrepreneurs aren't very educated. When I was doing my research there, one of the local papers had a government statistic when they had done some reports on entrepreneurs in Wenzhou, and they reported that 80% of them had an education of 8 years or less. So these were people that really were not formally prepared for what they were doing. When you read those Wenzhou books, usually they say the reason they're so good at business is because it's kind of a geographical determinism. It's a very mountainous area, so they had poor contact with the interior of China, and so they turned to the ocean, and they you know, were good traders internationally, and they set up outposts in different parts of Asia and in Europe. They also just developed this culture where people take pride in it. I think it's kind of self-determination that they believe, I'm from Wenzhou, I can do business. And the thinking is really very different from anywhere else. One time I was there for Valentine's Day. It's a great place to spend the holiday. And I picked up a copy of a local paper, which is called Fortune Weekly. And they had a Valentine's Day supplement. And they had done a survey of Wenzhou millionaires. And they asked them questions like, where do you like to go to dinner for Valentine's Day with your wife or your girlfriend and so on. And then they had some questions whose responses I think could only happen in Wenzhou. One of them was, what was the time in your life when you experienced the deepest emotion? And the two most common responses were, one, when I started my business, and two, when I got divorced. And another question was, if forced to choose between your business and your family, which would you choose? Which, first of all, is not a question you would have in a Valentine's Day report in an American newspaper, or probably in most parts of the world, but this is a great question. And I think it was answered pretty honestly, because 60% of the people chose their business, and 20% chose their family, and 20% couldn't make up their mind. But anyway, this is a place where, you know, people have this mentality, and they're totally fearless and totally flexible. And so when I started to look into and figure out the history of these lingerie dealers in Egypt, I found the people who had been the pioneers. And one of the pioneers of this industry was a man named Lin Xianfei. And like many people, he had had a pretty poor background. He had only gone to the fifth grade. He grew up in the rural part outside of Wenzhou. He learned to do trade in clothes and eventually went to Beijing and worked in a place called Yaobaolu, which some of you have been in Beijing may remember. It was a big market in the 1990s. A lot of Russians and other people would trade there, Central Asians as well. In 1999, with the Asian financial crisis, the business kind of dropped there. And so he was looking for something else to do, and he had heard that some people from near his village had gone to Egypt. So he had this idea, I'll go to Egypt and find something to do, really with no other plan than that. And so he looked on some maps and did a little bit of research, and he decided that Asyut is the most populous place in Upper Egypt. So he said, well, I'll go there. There's a lot of people in Asyut. There's got to be something that I can sell them. And his other thinking was that there's not many Chinese. It's unlikely to have many other Chinese there. It turned out his research wasn't perfect, because actually the place with the most population was Luxor, but Asyut is relatively big. And when he went there the first time, he flew there and he packed a bunch of stuff in his luggage, and he had three products that he brought: pearls, neckties, and women's underwear.
And I asked him, well, why did you have those three things? Like, what's the connection between pearls, neckties, and women's underwear? And he said, they're all small. You can fill up a bag with them really easily. So that was all. That was his only thinking. That was his market research was just what could fit in his bags. So he shows up there. I mean, men in Egypt, you know, they wear galabeahs, and especially in Upper Egypt, you don't need a necktie. So the neckties were totally worthless. The pearls were not of a great deal of value either, because Egyptians tend to buy gold or other jewelry. But he learned that the underwear sold very well. And so he started to focus on that. And eventually his wife came out to help him. But this instinct that he wanted to find a remote place to do this was really common when I talked to these people. And in some ways, this is different from the traditional ways of doing business from when people go to other countries. It's not really a colonial setup. I mean, these guys are actually trying to get away from Chinese people. That was one of their biggest goals. And when I met with many of the other people in Egypt, they would have stories about this. Like the guy, Ye Haijun, who was in Minya, he had previously been selling construction materials in Azerbaijan. And I asked, well, why'd you leave? And he said, well, there were too many Chinese started showing up, so I had to leave. There was another guy who had been selling winter coats in Siberia. And he said, too many Chinese came, so I went to Egypt. Another guy was a crab fisherman, and he got, you know, too much competition, so he went to Egypt. One of the dealers told me, he said, it's the Chinese brain. If the business is good, then others come and they show up and they ruin everything for you. He's like, but if you go to a place like this, which is very difficult and very remote and very unpleasant, then it's hard enough that your competition doesn't come. So this is what Lin Xianfei had decided. And he had moved there with his wife and eventually his daughter and her husband. And that's the daughter who went by the English name Kiki and her husband John. And they sold basically two types of things that filled a very specific niche. One is these kind of, you can see some of the dresses in there. These are sort of light dresses, which in Egypt you would never wear on the street, especially in Upper Egypt. A woman usually wears heavy, often black clothes, nothing colorful, and certainly nothing revealing. But it's very unpleasant to wear, you know, it's 110 degrees, you know, up to 40 plus degrees centigrade in the summer. So you don't want to wear this when you're at home, when you're just doing housework and so on. So they have a whole separate wardrobe. Women in Egypt have to have another entire wardrobe that they wear at home when other men can't see them. And so that's part of what they were selling. And then they were also selling the lingerie. And this is because of a big tradition in Egypt is that marriage is a really complicated transaction, and each partner in the marriage, in an Egyptian marriage, has to bring a lot of goods to the table. The man traditionally buys an apartment, and he buys the major furniture, and the wife is responsible for having small appliances and kitchenware and clothing, and she also needs to acquire a large amount of lingerie. This is part of the tradition, to show that she's ready for marriage. And I asked the Chinese about this, and one of them said, you know, he said, well, I think it's because they have to wear so many clothes that are so dark and so not, they're not distinctive. And so they like to have something nice to wear at home, he said. You know, it's hard on a person psychologically, he said, to never have a chance to sort of look nice. That was his idea of this. But this tradition with marriage is a big thing. And buying this stuff was really ritualized. When I would spend a lot of time in the shop with Kiki and John, and you know, just seeing who came in there. And these scenes were really surprising to me. One time I was there and a bride came in, or she was a fiance, she was engaged. She was 19 years old. Clearly, I could tell that she was a college student. She seemed sort of local middle class. She was wearing a type of hijab that was quite conservative. So I could tell she was a very proper, very conservative Upper Egyptian woman. And she was there with her fiancé and with her mother and with her 16-year-old brother. And this whole group of all four of them go through there. And then they start to go through the lingerie. And Kiki immediately notices what they're doing, and she starts to give them things. And one of the first things she gives them was this thing, which is called Lady Stocking Spring Butterfly in English. And she gives her this, and says, oh, you know, this is great. And the bride looks at this very carefully, and then she passes it to her fiance,
who studies it, and then he passes it to the mother, who also studies it, and they pass it to the 16-year-old brother, who studies it maybe longer than anybody else. And this is, you know, this is all done very seriously and without any sense of embarrassment. And they were there for more than for more than an hour, and they bought, you know, 25 of these nightgown and bra and panty sets, and some of these things were very racy. At one point, Kiki like brought up this pink G-string and gives it to them, and she's like, "What do you think?" And the fiance says, "Wallahi, wallahi, laziz," which means by God, you know, by Allah, it's beautiful, you know. And so it was just amazing. I didn't take pictures of this because I didn't want to throw things off, but that's the mother there laughing at, as they're negotiating, and that's Lin Xianfei's wife, Chen Saimei. But it was this very interesting process that, you know, I couldn't imagine that, you know, an American woman who was very open about sex and open about her relationship and comfortable with herself still would never want to be in that situation where you're shopping for lingerie with your 16-year-old brother and your mother and your fiancé. And so this was fascinating to me. And I realized that it was a ritual. It was part of the marriage. And from in their minds, it really had nothing to do with sex, actually. This was just, you know, a kind of a joyous occasion where she was preparing for marriage. It was just part of it. Anyway, it was, so I would spend time in these shops watching this. And I noticed the Chinese, I would ask them about this, but they weren't, didn't really care. They weren't very interested in this. You know, one time I was there and this big sheik showed up and he had two wives with him, two women with him in niqabs. And the whole time they're shopping for this really racy stuff. And I was wondering, are these both his wives or what's the story here? And afterwards I talked to Kiki and she said, no, I think one of them was his mother and one of them was his wife. And I think, well, that's even more interesting actually. But they generally weren't very curious about this. I was also struck by the Chinese didn't have a lot of preparation for what they were doing. They weren't really connected to the culture, to the language. I never met one of these lingerie dealers who had studied Arabic formally. And actually I never met one who even had a Chinese Arabic dictionary. They would just show up there and learn whatever words and whatever phrases were necessary on the fly. Egyptian Arabic is an inflected language for gender, so men and women speak in different ways. And because these guys spoke almost entirely with women, they all picked up the feminine way of speaking, which of course sounds really funny if you're a man in Egypt. And so like the Chinese guy, when he's bargaining, people would say, "Ana zalana," which is I'm angry, but he's saying it the way that a woman would say it in Arabic. And they were totally unaware of this. But they also, you know, they learned very specific things. All of them could make political jokes in Arabic because the Egyptians like to joke about politics and the Chinese learned to do this. They could make a joke about the Muslim Brotherhood or about Morsi or Sisi. One of the things they would often say is, oh, that price that you want under Morsi, we could have done it, but now it's Sisi, we can't do it, sorry. But it was, and they didn't really know much about the religious traditions either. One time I was talking to a guy, one of these Chinese dealers, and he said, the guys that wear the crosses, are they Muslim? And I said, no, those are Christians. He's like, oh yeah, right, no, I forgot. And there was also another one who talked to me about, he's like, the women that wear the hijab were Muslim, but the ones who wear the niqab are Arabs, he said. And he talked of these as if they were different religions. In his view, these were totally different faiths. He didn't see it as both is Islamic. And in some ways, this runs counter to what you would expect for people doing business in a sensitive topic in a sensitive area. We sort of assume that the more that you know, the better equipped you're going to be to dealing with your customers. But here it was the opposite that was true. The Chinese knew very little about the culture, and they really didn't care very much. And somehow this actually put the Egyptians at ease. Because they didn't see these people as gossipers. They didn't see them as prying. The other competitive advantage that they had was that, first of all, in Upper Egypt, it's very rare for women to work. In Egypt as a whole, less than 25% of women are employed. And in conservative areas, that rate is even lower. And it's very, very unusual for a woman to run a business. So you really wouldn't have Egyptian women doing this. They wouldn't be the boss of this kind of shop. And an Egyptian man would make a lot of customers uncomfortable. And so the Chinese had sort of found their way instinctively into this niche. They often had an Egyptian assistant. This is Kiki with her assistant, Rahma Medhat. And a lot of the women who were working in these places were from families where they needed money. In this case, I think she had some sisters who were trying to get married, and her father had died. And so she needed to make money for their dowry so they could buy the lingerie and the other things that they needed to get married. One thing I noticed was that these young women who work with the Egyptians tended to be who work with the Chinese were very loyal to the Chinese. They often told me, I'll never work for an Egyptian after this, because the Chinese are so straightforward and they don't gossip and they don't talk about things, and it's much more comfortable for me. One thing that she said was they keep their secrets. When I asked another woman about why it was that they did this business, she said, I can't really describe how they do it, but they can look at the item that they're selling and they can give it to the customer, and that's it. She said, you know, an Egyptian man might look at the item, but then he would also look at the woman and he might make a joke or maybe he would laugh about it. She said of her boss, she said, he doesn't have anything in mind, it's her Chinese boss, he doesn't have anything in mind when he's selling it. When you buy something, you can feel the thoughts of the person who's selling it. But with the Chinese, their brains don't go thinking about women's bodies. And there was this sort of, she described this kind of blankness, which was almost like a Taoist or something. And so it was interesting to me. And so in some ways they were very clueless. You know, they didn't poke into the cultural issues, but they were incredibly observant of the things that mattered to them. Lin Xianfei, after he had been selling lingerie in Asyut for a while, he noticed that there was a lot of trash in the area, which of course anybody would notice. But he had the idea, he's like, they're just throwing these bottles away. Why don't we try to recycle them? So we went back to Taizhou. He was from a place near Taizhou in Zhejiang. And that area, Taizhou, is famous for reprocessing garbage in China. And he figured out what kind of equipment you need to do this business. And he imported this massive machine from Zhejiang to do this, and set up this assembly line. This is where they sorted, and he hired about 30 Egyptians. And there's also these big machines that grind this stuff up. And, you know, he's not an expert at this. He's not very educated. His wife actually was illiterate. And he set this thing up, and he was getting the machines going. And he was tinkering with one of the machines, and a worker turned it on and with his arm in it, and broke his arm in five places and tore all kinds of, you know, he had to have skin grafts. He had to have skin grafts on his face. You know, this is in Asyut, in a really terrible place. He spent a month in the local hospital. He said, oh, you know, it was only $1,200. It wasn't very expensive. And he had survived this and had successfully set up his factory. So these people were incredibly tough. And this factory, because there was nobody else in Upper Egypt reprocessing bottles, they very quickly were making between $50,000 and $100,000 a year doing this. They had more bottles than they could possibly recycle. And finally, some Egyptian copied their idea, poached some of their workers, and set up the same business. They were selling, after they would grind up the plastic, they sold it to another Chinese person in Cairo who had set up a factory where he turned those flakes into thread. And then he sold the thread to other Chinese who were manufacturing clothes, including lingerie. And so this means that if you had a bottle in Asyut that was thrown on the ground, it would pass through three different levels of Chinese processing before it would be turned into lingerie and possibly sold by another Chinese person. So it's really an amazing thing. And for me to think of this, you know, in the West, we have been trying to develop Egypt for years. There's billions of dollars of aid that go into Egypt from America and from other countries. And this is a business that employed 30 people and employed many other people who are collecting this material and selling it to the Chinese. And it's getting rid of waste. You know, this is a great idea for a business. But why was it started by two people from Zhejiang, one of them who has a fifth grade education and the other one who's illiterate? It was really an amazing question to me. Lin was not somebody who talked a whole lot, but one time when we were driving in the town, I asked him, I said, what do you think is the biggest problem in Egypt? And his answer really surprised me, because he was very forceful when he said this. And what he said was, the biggest problem is inequality between men and women. Here the women just stay home and sleep. If they want to develop in Egypt, the first thing they need to do is solve this problem. That's what China did after the revolution. It's a waste of talent here. Look at my family. You see how my wife works. We couldn't run the factory without her, and my daughter runs the shop. If they were Egyptian, they wouldn't be doing that. And so it was interesting to hear this from him, and I heard this from many of the other dealers. You know, coming from the outside, I mean, I think during these years, at least in the press in American Europe, there's a lot of fear associated with the Chinese push into Africa and other countries, which I think is understandable because a lot of the pattern is, is to go after resources, and people are concerned about environmental issues. Sometimes the Chinese are fitting into old colonial patterns. But at the same time, there's another side to it, which I think is pretty fascinating. And Egypt was a good place to see that. In Egypt, the Chinese weren't involved in resource extraction. The numbers are relatively small. There are about 10,000 Chinese in Egypt. But the fact that they came from totally outside, to me, was fascinating. When you're a Westerner coming to a place like Egypt, there is really a lot of baggage. And sometimes it can be somewhat exhausting to arrive there with all this consciousness of the history and of the traditions. You think about the legacy of colonialism with the French and then the English in Egypt. You think about the Israel-Palestine issue. It's impossible for an American to go to Egypt without thinking about that issue. The Chinese are really disengaged from all of this. They don't have any colonial history in this part of the world. They deal with both the Israelis and the Palestinians. And so there was a sort of openness that I came to appreciate. I had a diplomatic friend from another Asian country who spoke Chinese well and knew the Chinese very, very well in Egypt. The diplomats, when I was talking to her about this project and what I observed, she said, "That's exactly what I notice in the diplomatic corps." She said, "The Chinese will sell people anything they like. They don't ask any questions. They don't care what you do with what they sell you. They won't ask whether the Egyptians are going to hold elections or oppress people or throw journalists into jail. They don't care about that." She said, "The Americans think if everybody is like me, they're less likely to attack me." Well, the Chinese don't think like that. They don't try to make the world be like them. Their strategy is to make economic linkages so that if you break these linkages, it's going to hurt you as much as it hurts them. And I asked her, "Well, what are the Chinese pushing? Like, what idea are they pushing?" She said, "To be honest, I think that even within China, they don't know what kind of ideology they're going after." And it was interesting because the Chinese were setting up a Kaifachu, a development zone in Egypt, up near the Suez Canal, up in this part of the country. And so this was really a government-driven project. That was supposed to promote China there. And this is something last year China announced that they're building 118 economic zones in 50 countries around the world. And this is partly to encourage domestic industry to move abroad, but also to push their stand in these countries. And when you go to the Egyptian zone, it's a really fascinating experience because you're driving in this area, it's all desert. And then in the distance, you see this little cluster of buildings, 6 square kilometers. And you go to the entrance and there's these kind of weather-beaten Chinese and Egyptian flags. And then you go in the middle and they've got this kind of, all of a sudden the language changes to Chinese. And you have, Shanghai Road and Tianjin Road combined with Port Said Avenue and Alexandria Avenue. The Chinese had built dormitories for workers and factories, the kind of thing that they did in China. But it was interesting because whereas I noticed that the lingerie dealers had been remarkably successful, the government made a big mistake, which was assuming that workers would come there and live in the dormitories and work in the factories. And what they didn't realize is that no Egyptians would allow their daughters to do this, and no Egyptian men would work in a factory. And all the entrepreneurs there told me, the Chinese women are great workers, the Egyptian women are great workers, but they can't stay in the dormitory. So they had to be bussed in from the nearest city, which was an hour and a half away every day. And so they couldn't run multiple shifts. They couldn't do night shifts. And the workday was really shortened. And this was a huge problem. And so many of these entrepreneurs were struggling in this. And so it was interesting to me that the same issue, the merchants had found a way to capitalize on the status of women in Egypt by setting up these shops in Upper Egypt. But when the government came in to try to do a planned project, they found themselves on the other side of this issue. They lost out because of it. They lacked the flexibility that the people from Zhejiang had. Those instincts somehow didn't kick in.
I got to know one of the guys who had a factory there. He was there for a couple of years, and he finally ended up leaving and going back to China. But it was very interesting talking to him because he had managed plants in China as well. And he said, you know, in China, the young women that I had in the factory, he's like, they go to work because they want to get out of the village. They want to escape. That's their goal. They don't really know what they're looking for necessarily, but they just want out. And then they go to the factory and they're in the dormitories and their ideas start to change. And sometimes, and anybody who has spent time in Chinese factories knows this. My wife's book, Factory Girls, is really focused on this. And many of these, when you talk to Chinese, these young girls in the factories, they often have incredible ambitions. And it was fascinating talking to the Egyptian women. And this Chinese entrepreneur, he said, but it's different in Egypt. He said, the women here aren't trying to escape. He said, they're actually trying to make money so they can just get married and go into the system. The motivation was totally different. And it was a very perceptive point. So when I talked to Egyptian factory workers, these women, I would ask them, do you want to start a business? Do you want to start this kind of factory maybe someday? And they thought that was a ridiculous idea. This was something that they would never have conceived of. Whereas a Chinese, even somebody with a moderate education, is often dreaming of this sort of thing. From my perspective, this was the real value of this, and I would go regularly to talk to the Chinese because I sort of liked the simplicity of their reactions and the fact that it was all so much based on pragmatism. There wasn't really an agenda behind it, but there was a kind of clarity. I also noticed that from their perception of Egyptian politics was totally different. I mean, I think for Westerners, when the Arab Spring happened, most of us saw it as a very inspiring thing and a revolution that was starting from the grassroots. But from the Chinese perspective, they usually saw it as the collapse of a weak state, not the rise of a powerful revolution. And when you talk to them about the issues in Egypt, they rarely talked about politics. They didn't say a lot about Islamism or the Muslim Brotherhood or the military, or this leader or that leader. What they talked about were social issues. They would talk particularly about that issue of gender, but also about the way families functioned in Egypt and the way that these very deep traditions hampered development. And you know, it made me think about sort of the arbitrary nature with which we use this term revolution. Because actually in China, during the years that I was here, you could see the ways in which these social relations had been revolutionized. I think the status of women that I remember in the 1990s when I first came to China had really changed in the space of a decade. You would go to the countryside and people were much more positive about daughters than they ever had been in the past. And I think relations between the generations had also changed. In some ways, this was a revolution, but we would never call it that because there wasn't political change. Whereas in Egypt, where we have what we call a revolution, there's really no social change at all. And I sort of, by the end, sort of agreed with the Chinese that what we had witnessed there wasn't really a revolution. It was more a series of coups, and the issue was really social. It's important to remember that. And in Egypt, we looked at these relationships between husbands and wives and parents and children, between men and women. In Egypt, those relationships hadn't been changed by the Arab Spring. And until that happened, there was no reason to call it a revolution. So I'd like to stop there and open it up for questions now, if you have questions about this project or anything else.
Thank you for the enlightening lecture, Mr. Hessler. So may I invite Professor Merlies to come to the floor to host this question and answer session. To pose a question, please raise your hand.
Thank you. Your story is very intriguing here. However, there's one more thing that I'm really curious about and you didn't really mention. Actually, we all know that China is relatively a very homogeneous country. Like, people stick to their family, their community because of the cultural, language reasons. And like, I didn't really know anyone who really decided to move to Egypt around me, but and also you mentioned that all those dealers in Egypt, they know nothing or very few about the country they are living in. So I just want to know why they decide to go somewhere that's so far away from their home. And what's the, like, how do they really know that place? How do they decided to go to that place?
I mean, I think the movement in China is pretty general in the sense of, you know, the migration is what they say about 150 million people now, but most of that's an internal Chinese migration. But I think that as time passes, you see more of these people making the decision to go overseas. It's a logical step. You know, they've often exhausted some of the possibilities locally, and they realize that there are niches overseas. When, you know, the people that are making this decision, though, do tend to be from specific places. Like, there's a place in near Wenzhou called Qingtian, and that place is really famous for people going overseas. When you go to Qingtian, they have signs in like seven languages as you enter the town. And the people there, one of the fashions when I was researching there was earrings and jewelry made out of euros that had been melted in you know, to melt it down to make jewelry, you know, and then because you'd bring this back from working there. So you have places that develop a tradition of thinking overseas. You're not going to find this universally in China, but in very specific places like Lin, that guy Lin Xianfei, his, you know, his village had a couple of people who had gone to Egypt, and that got him the idea. And so he thinks, well, if I go there and if I get in trouble, there's somebody from my village in Cairo, and so I can, you know, maybe he'll help me. So you know, they get a foothold and they go. But it is an amazing thing. I mean, it's really, and sometimes seems totally illogical to us. But I think that also this appetite for risk in China is an amazing thing that is the, one of the drivers of this. People are really unafraid. They're willing to take these, you know, to take these big decisions and, you know, take the risk.
Thanks for the really fascinating stories. I'm just wondering, what do you think are the plans of these Chinese traders in Egypt? Or do they plan to move on to other profitable business, expand their business? And until what point do you think they will return to China?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, none of them plan to stay, almost none of them plan to stay long term. There was one guy, the guy that was the Huizhang. He was an interesting case because his children were actually in an Egyptian private school. They spoke very good Arabic, his daughters, which is really unusual. They had kind of settled there. And he used to say, you know, he's like, my children are raised on the Nile water, on the water of the Nile. And he's like, they're going to have something to do with Egyptian-Chinese relations. But he was the only person I met who had that kind of perspective. Most of them wanted to earn money and then go back home. Most of them had built buildings at home and they were going to go back and retire. That was Lean's plan. He was going to stick it out for a few more years, he hoped, and then go back to China. And they're usually, you know, they're very self-deprecating. I mean, I thought that was his business, to me, was amazing that he could do this and set up this recycling company in particular. But I mean, you talk to him or his wife and they'd be like, well, this is a crappy business. We're doing, you know, this is a terrible job. I'm an uneducated. Well, 没有什么文化,我就是一个普通人. I mean, you know, it's just, they really, you know, don't see themselves as doing anything special. And yeah, the goals don't tend to be really long term in terms of being there and setting up a family dynasty or something. Yeah, a lot of short term goals, basically. Mm-hmm. Wait, yeah, go ahead.
Well, my first question is about, have you tried to discover the social circle of the Chinese businessmen? Because by what you said, they have not much intention to learn Arabic well, except for the president of the committee you just mentioned, and they try to avoid the strong competition, so mm-hmm. they might move to a city with mm-hmm. Only a few Chinese men or less. So I wonder what's their social circle, that their life would be. And my second question is, suppose some of the businesses started before 2011. Are things changing, or is the situation different from Mubarak's era to Moses' era to Sisi's era?
Yeah, good question. I mean, the social circle for many of these guys consisted of Zhongyang Dianshitai. I mean, really, they had no social circle. They would just watch CCTV. And I mean, you know, they could speak some Arabic, but they did, you know, and it's the kind of things that a Chinese businessman wants to do, you're not going to do in Upper Egypt. Ganyabe, you know, it's not, that's, it's, you know, they're not going to be going out and drinking with their business partners. So they really have very bare social lives. I mean, that's part of the toughness that it takes. That, you know, I would ask them about this, and they're just like, I watched, you know, when I was in there, you know, we got that guy's apartment, and as I said, they were making $100,000 a year. It was a decent amount of money, but they live upstairs from the factory. You can hear the machinery. It's incredibly loud. And they're sitting on plastic lawn furniture, you know, really tough conditions with Zhongyan Denshitai playing. And that's really it. I mean, that's part of their toughness, you know, that they can do that. So it's really a bare social experience for them. And they see it as, you know, chikhu, you know, we're just, this is what we have to do. This is the way we can succeed. As far as how it's changed, I mean, things were economically better under Mubarak. And actually, in the last year, last fall, Egypt devalued their currency by 50%. So it's really, their economic situation is really bad. And a lot of these lingerie dealers that I knew have left. Kiki and John, they shut down their shop. The last time I was in Asyut was in June, and they had shut it down. The factory is still going, but Kiki and John returned to Zhejiang to figure out something else to do. So they're often very flexible. Some of them will go out for a while. Maybe they'll come back if the economy bounces back. But right now in Egypt, it's really tough to do trade because you can't repatriate any profits. It's very hard to do that. The currency is incredibly weak. So it's a tough time for Egyptians. It's also a tough time for Chinese doing business there. Yeah.
My name's Ming Lei. This is a fascinating study because I feel very familiar with this pattern of economy because I'm from the southern part of Jiangsu, and some of those small business, they run almost in the same pattern as those Zhejiang people. But traditionally, people in my village, they don't really go that far away. Mm. But this whole way of working day and night, 24 hours, no rest, no social life is so familiar. And I feel like this is really one of the major powers that behind China's economic miracle. And I have two questions. And one is that how about the second generation of those Chinese immigrants in Egypt? Mm-hmm. What if they get kids? Do they just leave their kids in the Zhejiang, in their own village, or what? And the second question is, did you notice any case of intermarriage? Mm-hmm.
Okay, yeah, those are good questions. Usually they don't have their children there. Kiki and John, I have a picture somewhere else, they did have their little girl who was maybe 2 years old when I first knew them. She was less than 2 years old. And I mean, it's a tough place to have a child. And actually she got some kind of eye problem that was really serious, and I finally convinced them to take her up to Cairo, and I introduced them to a doctor there, or the pediatrician who had seen my kids. And by the time they showed up, there was another lingerie dealer who had heard, and so they brought their kids. So I had all these Chinese lingerie dealers that I was taking to the doctor in Cairo. It's a tough place to have kids. They would sometimes have them when they're small, but once they go to school, just like migrants everywhere in China, they send them with the grandparents, basically. There were, you know, as I said, the Huizhang was the only one I really knew of who was educating the children there, and they were being educated in both English and Arabic. So his kids spoke Arabic, English, and Chinese, and of course, you know, also the Zhejiang dialect. But generally, that's very rare. Intermarriage is also not that common. You would see it sometimes more likely with Muslim Chinese, with Huizhu or other Shaoshu Minzu who are Muslim. I never met a Uyghur there. I think it's very hard for Uyghurs to go there, actually, and they tend to go to Turkey because their language is close to Turkic. But you did meet Muslim Chinese, and occasionally they intermarry, but not very often. They were quite segregated, you know. They had very good relations, and the Egyptians liked them. They were popular, and you know, when I talk to the Egyptians in these markets, Egyptians tend to be very friendly, and they're actually very solicitous of foreigners. They're very generous, And they won't let people, you know, treat you badly, basically. And so they were somewhat protective of the Chinese in these markets. They were also borrowing money from the Chinese all the time. And the Chinese were always trying to deal with this because Egyptians are terrible at managing money, basically. But the relations were pretty good in that sense. But they weren't really deep, so you didn't see a lot of intermarriage.
I'm sure there are lots of questions. I know that we have to get out of this room in time for the next users. It was actually in the back row, it was the gentleman who caught my eye.
Thank you, Professor Maurice. So my question is going back a little bit about your journalism. So in the beginning, you tell us that you start this story very coincidentally in meeting Chinese in your town. So I want to know if you are constantly looking for stories in your daily life and in your work, and how you decide to pursue stories. And do you have a bunch of stories that eventually not developed?
Yeah, I mean, this started because I was working on an archaeology story. And so, but when I'm doing something, I try to have extra time so I can wander around, and because you always learn something useful. Like I went to that museum to see what had happened there. And of course, I ended up finding these Chinese people, and that became another story and part of the book I'm working on. But even if I hadn't met them, it was useful for me to hear how people talked about this incident at the museum. I do try to keep things open. The advantage of writing for The New Yorker is that I don't have to publish that much. And so a newspaper reporter is too busy to do that. You know, you can't waste time. But I can kind of waste time. It's not wasted, of course. But I can be a little more flexible with my schedule. And so, yeah, there's tons of things that don't go anywhere. You know, sometimes I'll pursue something for a couple of days and I realize it's not gonna work out. It's still background knowledge that's helpful for me. But occasionally something like this. And so for the book I'm writing, the Chinese are not a focus of the book, but they play an interesting role in the book because they're kind of the outsiders whose commentary is interesting to me. They're non-Western, non-Egyptian. They bring in this totally foreign perspective, which I think is very useful to the reader, and it was very useful to me. I appreciated it. Yeah. Did we have a question here? Or?
I once.
I have one in the front row.
All right. I once met a young man coming through China into Hong Kong, and he told me he was researching a book on the middle class in Congo. And I asked him, well, why are you in China? He said, the middle class in Congo are Chinese.
Oh, yeah.
And he did describe tensions mm-hmm. in the community with that entrepreneurial middle class. And there seems to be none in the case of mm-hmm. Egypt.
Yeah.
Can you expound on that?
Yeah.
Is it because they're more niche
areas? Yeah, I think this is true, because I've always heard that there are real tensions in a lot of other places. You know, if I were doing a book on Chinese in Africa, I would have been able to go to these, but I never ended up going elsewhere in Africa. Basically, I made the decision to Egypt. There was so much happening there that I was just going to focus on that. And so my book is about Egypt, and the Chinese only in Egypt. I think Egypt is an unusual place in the way the Chinese behave and in terms of the role that they play. To me, it's very interesting for other reasons, but I do think this is true, that in places where they're fitting into an old colonial pattern, that's Congo and other parts of Africa, you see more tensions. And I have read about this and heard about this from people like Howard French. You can see that in his book, yeah.
I think I've got time.
Thank you. Sorry, I came all the way from Hong Kong U, so I really wish to ask you just two questions, and thank you. So it's very interesting when you talked about China and Egypt, and you mentioned one point which was also mentioned in an interview by Washington Post with you, that in Egypt is actually a very political moment rather than an economic moment. Mm-hmm. But in China, when you were in China, when Chinese economy was developing so fast, and it's actually, in a sense, it's the opposite. It was an economical mm-hmm. moment rather than political moment. But right now, as the Chinese economy slows down, starts to slow down, and how do you see this pattern will maintain, and how do you think that public opinions and freedom about talking about politics can break into the public sphere in China? And that's my first question.
Yeah.
And second question, because I'm from the Journalism Media Studies Center in HKU, and we are actually very interested in the trend of nonfiction writing in China right now. So it's been very popular, and you are one of the golden standards for many writers. They say they got inspiration from your books about nonfiction writing. So I just want to ask, what's your take on this current trend in China about nonfiction writing? Mm-hmm. And in your stories, you write about the lesser known people and parts of China very often. But in many Chinese journalists and writers, nonfiction writing, it seems that they are looking for more exciting stories and more drama in history, in politics. So what would you say to these nonfiction writers in China? And yeah, like your experience in this. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, as far as the political, I mean, it was an amazing experience to be in Egypt to see a very political moment, because we had never seen that in China. And in some ways, it's very sobering, because it showed me how difficult it is to really change the politics of the country. Because I think in Egypt, you would say, as of now, the revolution really is a failure. They've gone back to a very militarized state. It's more repressive than it was under Mubarak. It's very sobering to watch that. And you realize it's very hard to make these transitions. For China, it's impossible for me to predict. I always feel like there's nothing right in the immediate horizon in terms of big change politically. You know, I feel like the system is very stable. It's hard to change a system like that. And I feel like in China, you don't yet have the real push to change that. I think there's a fair amount of complacency. And you don't feel the deep unhappiness that you felt in Egypt, where the system really is in crisis. So I don't know how the change will happen. The positives are that I feel like Chinese are much more confident and better educated and more aware than I remember when I first went there 20 years ago. There's really no comparison. And I have to believe that that will make a difference whenever that moment comes. I think Chinese people are perfectly capable of changing their system, but they have to make the decision that they want to do that. And I don't think that has happened yet. As far as nonfiction writing, I mean, that surprised me when I published my books in China. I didn't really expect that there would be much interest in them. I thought that people would think that's something for foreigners and that's not really interesting to Chinese. So I was taken by surprise by that. I think, again, that's connected to this confidence. I think in the past, Chinese were very sensitive about how foreigners looked at China. They would feel like the foreigner is condescending to them, and maybe that's true in some cases, but in some cases it was oversensitivity. But I feel like now Chinese are confident enough to see an outside perspective. And they're also at a stage where they're becoming more introspective. I think, you know, for 20 years, Chinese, all they could think about was trying to improve their situation and to deal with this new climate. And now you do have a lot of middle-class people who are pretty educated, and they have a little bit of space, and they can step back and think, well, where are we? You know, where have we come? How has our country changed? What do we need to do? And I think at this moment, they're more interested in reading about themselves from a foreign perspective. So I feel like that sort of shaped the response to my books. This interest in nonfiction writing is fascinating to me. Part of it is maybe political, because you can sometimes do something with a long-form writing that you can't do in the news in China. But again, it's just this sort of general maturity, being able to think about things in a new way. There's also just a big market. China is a highly literate place. There's a lot of readers. And so if, you know, there's a market for nonfiction that there might not be in many other countries. So, you know, I think it's an exciting thing, and I hope it continues. You know, I'm glad that the books have served some purpose there for Chinese writers as well as readers.
Thank you for joining. Thank you for joining us. This concludes today's public lecture. On behalf of Morningside College, I would once again like to thank you for coming and sharing your work and your experiences with us. Thank you.
Really great talk.
Yeah, no, thanks very much. Thanks for everybody for coming, and it's been a real pleasure to be here. Thanks.